I'd like to introduce you to an extremely successful singer and songwriter whose name you presently may not know, but whose compositions you certainly will. Our guest today has composed hits such as these.
I've been thinking about you, be-bum-be-bum-be-bum. Something swinging about you, be-bum-be-bum-be-bum.
I only want to love you as you like it.
For me, sorrow's heaving around my head. It's been heard and it's been said that
some people think that kids today have gone astray. Well, they should know, 'cause they're all mixed up too.
Well, I ask you, what a way to treat a guy. What a way to cheat and lie. Because I wanted you.
Ain't that funny? I was just gonna say the same thing myself to you.
But what do you want if you don't want money? What do you want if you don't want gold? Say what you want and I'll give it you, darling.
Wish you wanted my love, baby.
I've been crying my heart out. Do you love me or do you love me not? If you keep trying, you'll hear me sighing. Forgive me not.
I can do it, and I'll do it. Just you watch me try.
And our guest today certainly can do it. A very warm welcome to John Worth, also known, we will hear later, as Les Van Dyke. Hi, John.
Hi, Mike. Thanks for having me on your show, and a big hello to your listeners.
As the song says, John, let's start at the very beginning, a very good place to start. Where were you born?
I was born, John Worsley, in the London Borough of Battersea on June 21st, 1931. A genuine Gemini.
Here's a bit of a personal question. What were your parents like? And what sort of child were you?
My mum Elizabeth noticed that as a child, I had something to say about virtually everything. So she nicknamed me Mouth O'Malley. By the time I went to big boys school, she devised a way to stop me endlessly ranting away at the dinner table. A wet dishcloth sloshed in my face usually did the trick.
Oh dear.
I digress. My mum was a much-loved person, a strong Welsh personality with a will of iron and a heart full of love for music and her family. Dad, who was Greek, came from Cyprus to England in 1928 and met my mum while working as a sauce chef at the Dorchester Hotel in London's West End.
Were your parents musical?
Mum at that time was singing as a duo with another girl. They called themselves the Sisters Dale, and often performed at the Argyle Street South Theatre in Birkenhead, Cheshire. My dad, I later discovered, chanted completely out of tune with accomplished ease in the choir of the Greek Orthodox Church in Notting Hill Gate. He couldn't strum a bouzouki, but I'm told he did a bloody good zorba, the Greek dance, after a few swigs of brandy.
I believe you were to be christened with a Greek name, but this was not to be.
When I was born, Dad insisted I should be christened Yanis Paraskos Skoudalidis after his family. But Mum said, he'll be christened John Worsley and that's that. If you're wondering where the Worsley bit came from, blame it on the 1930s Wall Street crash. Dad figured his foreign name wouldn't get him very far in the tough search for another job. So he found a map of England, closed his eyes and stuck a pin in it, landing on the small village of Worsley, a place of royal collection, no less. He then changed his name by deed poll from Skoudalidis to Worsley, and presto, many years and many games later, here I am.
What happened when you left school?
At 18, I got called up to do my bit. 2 years national service with the 1st Battalion of the City of London Royal Fusiliers. After basic training, I got posted to Germany, and my time with the lads gave me some of the happiest days of my life. Any opportunity, we got to sneak into an out-of-bounds drinking den, usually finished up with me jumping onto a tabletop and singing a few rowdy songs while the rest of my platoon busied themselves trying to win over the local ladies. Enough said.
What did you do, John, when your national service came to an end?
I was demobbed in 1951, and on return to Blighty found a job serving behind the counter in a grocery store. After work, I'd travel far and wide around London on bus and tube to find any pub with a pianist so I could get up and sing a song or two. Sometimes, I'd overstay my welcome and get politely asked to leave. I learned to politely oblige, since the alternative usually featured the sharp end of a bouncer's boot. Then I got lucky. I'd been singing full blast in a pub that had its own trio, piano, bass and drums, when a chap from the BBC came in, approached me and said, "How would you like to be on TV?" Wow! So a few weeks later, there I was, with other lucky hopefuls, in a BBC studio, doing my best to sing like Frankie Lane. The next day I got a telephone call from Oscar Rabin's office saying Oscar's wife had heard me perform on telly and Oscar would like me to audition for his band.
Fantastic.
Blimey. My mum thought I was having a fit. She was right. It was a fit of joy.
But your name was John Worsley. History shows that you performed under another name. How did this come about?
I was sitting in a bus on the way to my audition when I decided the name John Worsley didn't sit right for a singer. Then looking out of the window, I spied a poster for a West End show starring Irene Worth, a top star. So there and then I stole, well, borrowed her surname. And once again I got lucky. After the audition, I was signed up for 5 years with the Rabin Band, and my name was Johnny Worth.
What was life like in the Oscar Rabin Band?
I was one of three singers in the band, and we performed a huge variety of songs, twice a day, 7 days a week, from rock and roll to ballads, Broadway hits, skiffle, rumbas, jazz, you name it. Mel Gaynor, Marion Williams and I sang it.
Brilliant.
On reflection, I believe that experience gave me a deep-seated memory of the many ways a song can be musically shaped and lyrically created. Those 5 years gave me the key to where creatively I needed to go to achieve what I wanted to be, a songwriter. Towards the end of year five, I got the unexpected chance to do that very thing. I got laid off.
Laid off? Now, what would seem like very bad news actually had a silver lining for you, didn't it?
Lucky for me, I got asked by Oriole to sing on their Embassy label for Woolworths, the worldwide American superstore. So I was able to record many covers currently in the charts, and I got paid a tenner a track, a lot of money in those days.
Let's listen to one of the tracks you recorded on the Woolworths Embassy label, John. How about this one that covered one of Elvis's hits, King Creole?
Big soul, he lays down a beat like a ton of coal. He goes by the name of King Creole. You know he's gone, 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 jumping like a catfish on a pole. Yeah, he know he's gone, 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 hip shaking King Creole.
King Creole, King Creole.
When the king starts to do it, it's as good as done. He holds his kid like a Tommy gun. He starts to growl from way down in his throat.
He bends a string and that thong she wrote. You know he's gone, 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 jumping like a catfish on a pole. Yeah, he always gone, gone, gone. Well, I tip taking King Creole.
King Creole, King Creole.
Well, he sings a song about a crawdad hole. He sings a song about a jelly roll. He sings a song about a park and greens.
He wails some blues about New Orleans. You know it's gone, gone, gone. Jumping like a catfish on a pole. Yeah. You know it's gone, gone, gone. The chicken king be on. Let's go.
Something evil when he plays something sweet. No matter what he plays, you gotta get up on your feet. When he gets a rocking beat, baby, heaven sakes,
he don't stop playing till the guitar breaks. You know he's gone, gone, gone. Jumping like a catfish on a pole. Yeah, he was gone, gone, gone. That a chicken king trio. He know he's gone, gone, gone. That a chicken king trio.
Johnny Worth and his version of King Creole, one of the huge number of covers you did for the Embassy record label in the late 1950s and early 1960s. While you were recording the Embassy tracks, did you have any other work sort of running at the same time?
Shortly after being dropped by the Rabin Band, I got an offer to join three very talented people, namely Vince Hill, Jackie Lee and her husband Len Beadle. Together, we formed the close harmony vocal group The Raindrops, and in a very short time became well known on TV and radio and appeared in variety theatres all over the UK, backing most of the big names of the day.
The Raindrops' lead singer, Jackie Lee, went on many years later in 1971 to sing the top 20 hit Rupert the Bear. Let's wind the clock back, though, to when you were part of The Raindrops and listen to There Goes the Lucky One.
There she goes with a boy I love. There goes the lucky one. There she goes with a winning smile. Here stands the lonely one. I'll be the clock as they go walking by. There goes lucky one. He was mine for a little while. Now she's the only one. Love to the test and put me second best, and I lost him. Mary, go away. Why do you hold me night and day? His arms, his kiss. She's got everything I miss. There goes the lucky one, walking tall with her head up high. I hope she's having fun. I hope she knows that she goes with a boy I love. Mary, go away. Why do you haunt me night and day? She's got everything I miss. There goes the lucky one, walking tall with her head up high. I hope she's having fun. I hope she knows that she goes with the boy I love.
The Raindrops with lead singer Jackie Lee and There Goes the Lucky One, featuring our guest today, John Worth. Now, we've heard The Raindrops, of which you were part, and their hit There Goes That Lucky One. Did the group have any live appearances, John?
We were regulars on Drumbeat, Oh Boy, and most other TV music shows.
I think it was around this time that things really started happening for you.
It was around that time that I wrote What Do You Want? My first real attempt of being a songwriter. And also, I got signed up to record solo for Oriole.
Now, having written a song called What Do You Want, you had to find an artist to take it into the charts for you.
The bands and soloists on Drumbeat were socially a very close crowd, and I got along especially well with a lad called Terry Nellum, who, like me, for similar reasons, changed his name to Adam Faith. I saw in him something that was unusually magnetic, and remember thinking, this guy could attract women of any age. Even your grandma would sigh and say, ah, he's lovely. There came a time for Adam when, after a couple of failed releases via two different record companies, the brand new EMI label, Parlophone, showed an interest in releasing an Adam Faith single. One day, Ad casually approached me during a midday break and asked if I'd got any songs he could hear, since I'd been bending his ear all week after wanting to be a writer. I took a deep breath and mentioned, what do you want? And for me, the rest's history. Thanks to Adam and Parlophone, the very first song I ever wrote went to number one and stayed there for 19 weeks.
What do you want if you don't want money? What do you want if you don't want gold? Say what you want and I'll give it you, darling.
Wish you wanted my love, baby.
What do you want if you don't want honey? What do you want if you don't want those? Say what you want and I'll give it you, darling.
Wish you wanted my love, baby.
Well, I'm offering you this heart of mine, but all you do is play it cool. What do you want, oh boy, you're making a fool of me.
One of these days when you need my kissing, one of these days when you want me to, don't turn around cause I'll be missing. Then you want my love, baby.
Well, I'm offering you a diamond ring, but all you do is turn me down. What do you want, oh boy, you're going to
One of these days when you need my kissing, one of these days when you want me to, don't turn around cause I'll be missing. Then you'll want to my love, baby. Oh well, then you'll want to my love, baby.
What Do You Want by Adam Faith, that got to the very top of the UK charts in late 1959 and composed by our guest today, Johnny Worth. Tell us a little about the recording of the song, John.
We rehearsed the song with Les Reed at the piano and pushed hard for important things like singing with an English accent and bending vowel sounds, as with the word baby, distorting it at a peak point in the song for an audience to gleefully join in with, "Wish you wanted my love, baby." Les, a good friend and my on-the-road travelling companion, also familiarised John Barry with my pizzicato idea for the arrangement. But for me, the most important result was a change of direction away from American domination of the British charts. What Do You Want was performed, orchestrated and released on a totally British label by totally British musicians backing a totally British singer and written by a half-Cypriot, half-Welsh novice songwriter bearing the British nom de plume of Les Van Dyck. Complicated? Yeah, but it changed my life.
But John, the record shows the composer as Les Van Dyck. What happened to Johnny Worth?
Okay, I'll tell you. I was signed to Oriole as a solo singer named Johnny Worth. A short while later, the Raindrops got signed up to EMI and we made a single. I thought, quite wrongly, that since I was in a vocal group called the Raindrops, my name didn't come into it. But we discovered that Oriole could force the Raindrops single to be dropped by EMI because I was Oriole's artist signed to their label.
Oh dear.
Fortunately, this unforeseen cock-up occurred before Adam showed EMI What Do You Want. I figured that since I was the cause of the mess, my name at EMI could well be mud and maybe they wouldn't touch my song with the barge pole. So, what to do?
What did you do?
I phoned my mate, Les Reed, and begged his advice. He said, "Change your name." I said, "Yeah, good idea." Then he said, "What's your telephone exchange?" I said, Van Dyke. Then he said, that sounds good. And I said, great. Would you mind if I use your Christian name, Les? He said, be my guest. And that's how I morphed into Les Van Dyke. When Adam hit the number one spot, I decided to stick to Les Van Dyke like glue.
So what happened next?
The joyful aftermath of What Do You Want, Parlophone's very first release, was almost instant. Poor Me, the next release, also went straight to number one. And eventually, over a period of time, I wrote a string of hits for Adam, including B-sides and album tracks, and for films Adam starred or appeared in.
You mentioned Poor Me going straight to number one. Only a couple of months since What Do You Want had been at that position. Fantastic. Nothing Poor Me about you both at that time then.
Poor me, poor me, sorrow's heaping around my head. It's been heard and it's been said that you tried to date another guy, didn't hide, didn't even try, cheating me with lies again, making me remember when I used to hold you by the so tight each night. That's right, I kind of hope that maybe you might fall for me. Oh, why the voice inside of me sit and cry? This was meant to be love's unkind and love's untrue. Oh, why did love pick out you for me? For me, for me, for me. I used to hold you, baby, so tight each night. That's right, I kind of hope that maybe you might fall for me. Why? Your voices say to me, sit and cry, this was meant to be love's unkind and love's untrue. Oh, why did love pick out you for me, for me, for me, for me?
Poor Me, sung by Adam Faith and composed by Les Van Dyke, the nom de plume of our guest today, John Wirth. Now, your success wasn't only with Adam Faith, though, John. Your fame as an established number one hitmaker was spreading, I guess.
Gradually, after success with Adam, my phone began ringing more often as I got approached by managers asking me to write for their artists. One of the first was a guy who'd been rechristened Eden Kane by his management. His real surname was Sarstedt, and he was one of three singing brothers. Well, I wrote Will I Ask You for him, and it took just 7 days to climb to number one.
Will I ask you, what a way to treat a guy, what a way to cheat and lie, cause I wanted you. Well, I ask ya, did you have to beat me down? Did you have to go to town and smash my world in two? I don't think you're getting away with it. You're gonna pay me somehow. You cruelly wrecked my life, but oh, you want me now. Oh, baby, just you ask me. Get down on your knees and try. I won't break till I see you cry like me when I ask you. Getting away with it, you're gonna pay me somehow. You
cruelly wrecked my life, but oh, you want me now. Just you ask me, get down onto your knees and try. I won't break till I see you cry like me when I ask you. Well, I ask you. Well, I ask you. Well,
we followed up with Get Lost and then Forget Me Not, the song that will always be for me the nicest pop song I ever wrote.
Brilliant.
John Keating, the renowned Scottish musician, created superb arrangements and also many of the later scores for Adam Faith tracks after John Barry, a great arranger himself, went solo and carved himself a historic future via his unique film scores.
Been crying my heart out. Do you love me or do you love me not? If you keep trying, you hear me sighing. Forget me not. I've been wearing my mind out. To have you close, I'd give all that I've got. The love we tasted, has it been wasted? Forget me not. Just a lucky guy. Forget me not. Forget me not. Whoa, I lay me down to die. Love is the one big lie. There's no need to remind me. Love's a fire when the kisses grow hot. So take this ember, then you remember. Forget me. Just a lucky guy. Forget me not. Forget me not. Whoa, I lay me down to die. If love is the one big lie, there's no need to remind me. Love's a fire when the kisses grow hot. So take this ember, then you remember. Forget me.
As nearly all great composers do, John, you didn't limit yourself to the pop music world.
As a writer of songs for specific singers and later on for stage and screen, I began to enter different worlds that required different approaches to writing. Eventually, I went to Hollywood with John Keating, where John wrote the film music, and together we wrote the songs for the movie Hotel.
Fantastic.
I'd always avoided collaboration with another writer simply because, for me, it didn't work. I knew what I wanted and where I wanted to go with it, but vanity can be a fool's road, and John Keating helped me avoid the journey. I wasn't a trained musician. As to my piano plonking, I'm known as the beast with three fingers. I wrote, and still do, in my brain. That's where I hear my music. John introduced me to a world of orchestration. He taught me to physically write music, to arrange, to understand the complex language of dots, breves, minims, crotchets, rests, major keys and minors, chord progressions. But above all, he taught me to be daring. Carmen McRae sang most of the songs we wrote with the film, and later asked us to write a song for her forthcoming album. To this day, I can't play that track without emotional tears coming to my eyes. She's a fantastic artist, and I will always think of her standing there like a sad angel as she performed our songs with gentle elegance. The song is called It's Not Going That Way. Music, John Keating. Lyrics, John Wirth.
And here is that track, sung by Carmen McRae, that still overwhelms you with emotion. It's not going that way.
kitty car to paradise. Zooming along through a candy-colored day, laughing like crazy as we bump along to love. But it's not going that way. To fly where I've never spread my wings before, looping the loop like a bluebird out to play, warbling my head off with a serenade to love. But it's not going. Somewhere along this zigzag road, your heart stopped dancing with me. Somebody stole my ticket to paradise. Like a baby's never cried before. So where do I go on this melancholy day? You know I love you and I'd like to tag along, but it's not going that way.